The dust is still settling from WWDC. Developers are out there playing with all the new stuff. Swift 6 and concurrency and all that is now here. So let's talk about it. And as always, links to everything you see in this show are in the GitHub repo. The link to that is in the description. All right, let's dive in. Today's video is sponsored by Squarespace. Swift 6 and the new concurrency rules are officially here, well, at least in beta form anyway. And I recently spent a couple days converting my day job app, Podcast AI, over to all the new Swift 6 stuff. Turned on strict concurrency checking, made them errors, went to Swift 6, all that. We're fully converted. And that's why I wanted to talk about this, because I probably had like one of the easiest migrations possible, right? We haven't even launched yet, so it's a pretty new app. I just started it like a couple months ago. I've built the entire code base from scratch, so I know all the code. We're not really relying on any third-party libraries, so this is like the easiest possible migration you could possibly have. And it still took me 2 full days. I mean, most of the warnings were pretty easy to clear, but not all of them. I mean, some of the times I had to like sit down, rethink my code, restructure some things. And if you're working with a Swift data app, Swift data model objects in sendable are kind of tough. I mean, yeah, you can, you know, pass the persistent ID, that's sendable, cross actor boundaries with that, then refetch, but it just felt like cumbersome. But like I said, my migration was as easy as possible, still took me 2 full days. So it really opened my eyes to how difficult this transition is going to be for a lot of people. And Alex here in this article on Swift 6 discusses some of these issues, but I'll sum this up. Definitely check out this article, dive in, read. But the two things he points out that are some of the major issues are that a lot of this data race safety stuff, the reality is quite different with too much of the work shifted to the developer, because it does kind of get shifted to us. Like, yeah, we'll check it at compile time, but it's on you to make it right. And then his other point, which I kind of agree with, kind of don't, I'll scroll down here, basically that the rollout is happening too fast. So that's down here in the suggested solution. Adding async await and actors, already huge win, I agree. But everyone is still in the process of adopting these new APIs. I also agree. Like, yeah, I've been using async await since it pretty much came out, but I just started really diving into the realm of, you know, actors and all that stuff. So I think the community as a whole is still like getting their feet wet with this stuff, still adopting it. He goes on to say, eliminating data race issues at compile time, it's a compelling idea, but I think neither the community nor the features are ready. So that sentiment I kind of agree with, but Apple also made this opt-in. Like, you don't have to do it. And I imagine it'll be at least a couple years before, you know, you feel like you need to be on Swift 6. But my advice, again, after my little 2-day, super simple, very easy migration, is if you think Swift 6 is the right call for your app, your code base, because it's not going to be the right call for everyone. So don't think you have to do this. And it is opt-in. But if you think you do want to go on this journey, I would start sooner rather than later. And I think Apple's done a pretty good job with their migration guides. And here it is, migrating to Swift 6. Here's the overview, you know, walking you through it. But there's some more articles down here at the bottom. Data race safety, migration strategy. And then this one is really helpful. Common compile errors. If you click on this, I use this religiously during my conversion here. Again, sendable type. I'm not going to like read through all the common errors, but I'm going to scroll through fast. You can see they talk about many of the common errors you're going to run into when doing this conversion. And they also have a full like 40-minute long Migrate Your App to Swift 6 WWDC video. So these resources were super helpful. And then one last resource I wanna leave you with, because it's not just your code, right? If you have a lot of third-party libraries, you're gonna have to rely on those other third-party libraries to upgrade to Swift 6 before you can. And Dave and Sven here of Swift Package Index are tracking this. Here's an article about tracking all the third-party libraries, seeing how ready they're going to be for Swift 6. And as of a couple weeks ago, 43%, I believe, of the packages out there were Swift 6 compatible and had zero data race errors. You see, for the past week, the Swift Package Index build machines have been running all the fresh builds to check this stuff. And there's two checks that you want to look at, because down here, data race safety indicators, there's a note down here, safe from data races. That's one thing, because just being compatible with Swift 6 doesn't necessarily mean you're safe from data races. So don't look at Swift Package Index like, oh, this package compatible with Swift 6, good to go. Make sure you look for this safe from data races to know that it's up to date with the Swift 6 concurrency. And I believe all this means is that it builds without any errors or warnings with strict concurrency checking on. They could just have unchecked sendable all throughout their code base, I guess. And then, you know, that would get it to work. But we're going to trust that the third-party libraries you're using are, you know, building things correctly. But if you do want to know if those libraries are ready for Swift 6, again, Swift Package Index, look it up. They'll have this safe from data races and Swift 6 compatible. Moving on, I want to share again the SwiftUI field guide. I shared this a few months back, but they keep updating it. And now here we have LazyVGrid. And if you're not familiar with the SwiftUI field guide, it is very visual. So if you want to learn about LazyVGrids, here you can see some basic code and you can drag around to play to see how the grid adapts. When you have one column flexible, the other one fixed, and there's a whole bunch of these, I'm not gonna go through them all, but here you can play with adaptive spacing and again, change your size so the number of columns adapts to the screen real estate available. So the point is, look at this basic code, play around with the parameters, play around with the screen sizes, see how the code adapts. Again, super visual, super easy way to really understand what's going on with LazyVGrid. We're gonna talk about SF symbols again because I love them. And Natalia here has just a pretty good overview of all the ways you can customize the look of your SF symbols. So this is pretty basic stuff, but I like how it's all packaged into one space with visuals, right? So here's how you get the image of a star. The size you can change based on a font. There's variations. I'm scrolling down to the one that I really liked here. So you can change the font weight. So that's what like thin to bold will look like. You can change the image scale to make it bigger as well. Give it a color. Here we go. Put a gradient on your SF symbols. I had never thought to do that. So when I saw this, I was like, that's like a really good idea. Maybe even a mesh gradient, new in iOS 18, who knows? Like I said, I think mesh gradients are gonna be everywhere. And then rendering mode, right? If you want just the monochrome or multicolor down here, but just a nice review of all the ways you can customize the look and feel of your SF symbols. Moving on, let's talk about app intents in an article from Superwall and Jordan Morgan. And he has a line in here. I couldn't agree with more. Well, actually, I disagree with them. Let's talk about it. So here's the app intents field guide. App intents, right? Before this year, they were kind of for, you know, Siri shortcuts or interactive widgets, and they expose a little bit of functionality of your app to the system, is, you know, to put it simply, what they do. And it was kind of niche, right? Not many people had worked with app intents. You know, the shortcuts app is super powerful and awesome, but like I would argue not a ton of developers have great shortcut support. But anyway, that all changes this year with Apple Intelligence, because Apple Intelligence is going to use app intents to be intelligent, if that makes sense. So what Jordan said, what I agree with, is arguably it is now the most important framework that developers should know in today's landscape. And the reason I was joking, say I disagree with him, because I would eliminate the word arguably. I think it is the most important framework you need to know, because it's going to take a couple years for everyone to have a device that can use Apple Intelligence, for everyone to get used to using it. But once it becomes just commonplace to use Apple Intelligence, people are going to expect your app to be ready to handle whatever commands they use. So if they try to use Apple Intelligence with your app and it doesn't work, it's going to be a downer. And I bet once they get used to using Apple Intelligence and there's an app that doesn't play nicely with it, they're gonna look for an alternative. I just think Apple Intelligence is going to change the way people use their phones. And if your app isn't part of that, you might miss out here. So I wanted to keep banging the drum, learn app intents if you haven't done that yet. Again, I don't think this new paradigm, this new way people use their phones, I think it's gonna take a couple years to roll out and everyone to get used to it, but that gives you a couple years to really plan for it and prep. And then basically the rest of the article is Jordan saying what app intents are, how they work, and giving you some quick little tutorial examples on how to build them. We won't go into that. I just wanted to, again, bang the drum, learn app intents. Here's a great article to get you started. All right, it's Fat Bob Man time. I feel like I feature them in every episode, but they just put out great content. And this really struck a chord with what I've been thinking about lately for my day job app and podcast AI, List or LazyVStack, because LazyVStack and ScrollView got great improvements in iOS 17 with all the scroll transitions, the cool animations you can do, and you got even more control and fun stuff you can do in ScrollViews in iOS 18. So it feels like the LazyVStack and the ScrollViews are getting all the love with all the cool new stuff, whereas List, which is built on top of the old, you know, UI kit stuff, LazyVStack and ScrollViews, all the native SwiftUI. This is what this article talks about. It's like, which one should you use? Because there's pros and cons to both. Yeah, you get all the fun, cool new animations in the LazyVStack and the ScrollView, but you also get a lot of great stuff with List, like just built-in swipe to delete, built-in on move, built-in editing. A List is going to adapt whether you're on an iPhone, an iPad, a Mac, a watch, right? It's gonna just adapt automatically, whereas the ScrollView and LazyVStack won't. And that's what this article is all about, basically, is doing a deep dive on the differences between List and LazyVStack and the pros and the cons. So if you are considering for your app, like, should this be a List or should I put it in a ScrollView in a LazyVStack? Dive into this article. I think you'll find it insightful and hopefully you'll find your answer like I did. And if you're here staying up to date with the latest and greatest on Swift and SwiftUI, all the WWDC news, I know you're building great apps. And it's a pretty good idea to have a nice portfolio website to showcase your work. And that brings me to today's sponsor, Squarespace. Squarespace is an all-in-one platform to help you get that iOS developer portfolio up and running very quickly. Now I know, we're developers, we can build a website ourselves, but we're also iOS developers, and I would argue there's an opportunity cost of your time. Now, do you want to spend your time learning about web development, responsive design, all the different browsers, or do you want to spend your time building apps? So that's why I always recommend letting Squarespace take that off your plate to build your iOS developer portfolio. They have all kinds of beautiful themes and templates to get you started, and you can use their next generation website editor with the Fluid Engine to just really unlock all the creativity in the world. You can even use Squarespace Blueprint and Squarespace AI to help you figure out what to write on your website, because that's always the hardest part. Like, I don't even know what to say here. Throw it into Squarespace's AI and they'll help you out. They handle all the SEO and analytics for you. Again, Squarespace handling your website just takes so much off your plate. So when you're ready to get started, go to squarespace.com. And when you're ready to launch, go to squarespace.com/SeanAllen to get 10% off your first purchase of a website or domain. Wanted to share this quick little stat from Ariel at AppFigures. This is the most important trend every app developer must know about. And it's just summed up into one simple chart: app revenues versus app downloads. And obviously blue is the App Store, green is Google Play. Downloads slowly trending down, revenue just up and to the right. Love to see that growth in the chart. So just something to think about, right? People aren't necessarily downloading a ton of new apps, but I think what this shows, and this is just my opinion, is that it is becoming normalized to spend money on apps and subscriptions, right? We've gotten used to it as a society, as new generations come up that like grew up with it, right? Because if you're old enough, you're like, ah, I remember when apps were 99 cents and what's all this subscription stuff? But there's a whole new generation of people that just subscriptions are the norm. And I think we're seeing that as society is getting used to that. You know, whether you like that or not, good or bad, I just think we're just getting used to spending money on apps. And I think this chart really shows that. So do with that information what you will. I think it's positive, right? I would hate to see tons of downloads going up, but revenue going down, that would be a bad sign. So I think this is great for our industry, to be honest with you. I just think you got to make great quality apps that are worth the price to pay. Have you tried the new dark mode or tinted on iOS 18 yet? I'm currently rocking the dark mode with the large icons where you get rid of the title. I'm really coming around to it because I'm not going to lie. If I scroll down, when I first saw this at WWDC, I wasn't really a fan, especially of the tinted. But now that we've also done this at Podcast AI, you can see the three icons we worked on and put into the app. And now that I've been using the dark mode, I'm really coming around to this. So I guess I wanted to share this in case you were kind of fighting it. You didn't want to adapt your app icon because, you know, all the memes and stuff was how horrible tinted looked, but that's because not a lot of apps are ready for tinted. As you'll see in this guide, they walk you through how to do it, what are all the requirements, and if you make a good app for tinted, I think it can look decent. Now, of course, people can make all kinds of ugly color combinations, but it's not as bad as I initially thought when I first saw this at WWDC. What do you think? Have you converted your app icons? Did you have to make a ton of changes? Like, how did they come out? This one's short, but it is amazing. And it's from the What's New in App Store Connect WWDC video. It just says improved screenshot workflow. What that means is we now only need one set of screenshots for iPhone and one set of screenshots for iPad. No more of that small 5.5 inch iPhone and the two different iPad sizes. Makes creating screenshots way more easier. Again, this was just a quick little blurb in the WWDC video, but huge, huge improvement. Next up, I want to share a guest post on Swiftly. So this isn't from Antoine. It is from Jordi Bruin. And he talks about why macOS development is perfect for indie developers. And I saw him give a talk like how to build an app in 30 minutes and post it and start making money right away with a quick little Mac utility. And that's what this is all about. And I think a lot of people just, myself included, by the way, just sleep on the Mac. We don't think about it. And following Jordi, seeing his talk and what he's doing with Macs, he's got like over 20 Mac apps and they're all quick little utilities he built in a couple days, a couple hours that end up making good revenue. So don't sleep on the Mac and the little utilities. And that's what this article is all about. Talks about making little menu items, like another app Jordi's built is Bakery. Make a quick little app icon for developers. Or down here is another example. We'll scroll down. Let's get down to the bottom, down to the bottom. Like a speed test, quick little menu bar app, just do that, start speed test, right? You can probably make this app in 2 hours, but it's a very specialized utility and I think the Mac is great for that. So if you're interested in indie dev and maybe you don't have an app idea, read this article and give Jordi a follow his stuff, check it out, see what he's doing, and maybe you'll get inspired for some ideas because I think there's a lot of opportunity here. And if you want to learn more about the Mac, Karen Prater here, her YouTube channel. She does a lot of Mac stuff here, but this video is all about WWDC, what was new for macOS development in SwiftUI, and it's, you know, a good 30-minute video walking through all of the features. So if you're curious about Mac development and you want to see, like, what's all the new stuff before you dip your toes in, definitely check out this video from Karen. And lastly, I want to leave you with a little philosophical tweet here. Optimizing code is a true art form. Just like painting, it's all about layering. Too many layers, the beauty is lost. Too few layers, there's no depth. Striking a balance, like, that's where the magic happens. And I'm talking about kind of like structuring your code. If you have so many layers of complexity or layers of abstraction, like, that, the beauty is lost. But having no layers, well, that's not the right answer either, right? There's a balance in between. And just like art critics, everyone has an opinion about it. So I wanted to leave you with that thought. We'll see you in next month's episode.